Thank you so very much for this nice introduction, and thank you for coming out, even though it was so rainy out there this morning. So let's begin here. As we are nearing the end of the 100th commemoration of World War I, I have the enviable task to talk about the Central Powers. And what I have put up here on the introduction slide is, of course, the flag of the German Empire, which looked very different at the time, the Wilhelmine Empire. And up here we have the flag of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire, the dual monarchy, as it is called. On the right, well, your left, is the Austrian crown with the Austrian flag, and on the left is the Hungarian crown with the Hungarian flag, okay? Of course, these are not the only powers who are members of the Central Powers. There is also Turkey, or the Ottoman Empire, and Bulgaria. So Germany, Austria, Bulgaria, and Turkey are the Central Powers. As most of you know, the event that convinced European countries to consider war with each other was the assassination of the heir to the throne for the Austrian-Hungarian Empire, Franz Ferdinand. Very few people actually liked him, so they didn't cry off an awful lot when he was assassinated. The problem is that's a regicide that needs to be paid for. After 4 years of fighting and unprecedented carnage on several fronts, the Central Powers ceased to exist. Peace negotiators greatly diminished the size of the German Empire, carved up the Austrian-Hungarian Empire into all kinds of new countries, and brought about the fall of the Ottoman Empire. Most historians have focused on the military mistakes that the members of the Central Powers made in order to bring about their own demise, but I will be taking a different approach. I will be looking at individual leaders within the German Empire and the Austro-Hungarian Empire, how these egos or interests that they had clashed with each other and were major factors in bringing about the demise of the Central Powers. I will begin initially with the crisis in July 1914 that followed the assassination. I will then move on to address the conflicting strategies and how Austrians at times instigated battles to which the Germans had to come as a rescue party. And finally, I will address how the strained relationship between Germany and Austria limited coordination of communication, resources, and strategies. The clash of ideologies over war aims between the various leaders ignored the human aspect of the war. Indeed, there was a disconnect between what was happening on the war front and the home front, and how reckless decisions resulted in diminished resources, and ultimately all these conflicting interests brought about the demise of the Central Powers. First, let me introduce the major players who are part of these Central Powers. Of course, we have Kaiser Wilhelm II. He has been on the throne since 1888. He's a man who preferred military life over his government duties. He at times had an indecisive approach to governing. He would make up his mind one day and change his mind the following day. He encouraged government officials to resign if they would not implement any and all of his ideas. And he was very strong-willed. Here we can see a postcard of the Kaiser and his general command, or as some called it, his high command. You have individuals like Ludendorff back here. Here is the Chancellor, Bethmann Hollweg. Here is the Field Marshal, Paul von Hindenburg. Here is the famous Admiral Tirpitz. And here, of course, is the Kaiser. So he liked to live in this circle of generals and exchange ideas, plan strategy, and so on. Here we have an image of the Chancellor, the Reich Chancellor, Theobald von Bethmann Hollweg. He is very much a Prussian nobility. He exemplifies the Prussian civil service as it existed at the time period. He viewed the world in great terms, that you need to compromise with your opponents, that there are nuances to interests, nuances to military strategy. He viewed the world in gray terms. So he was very much, if it came down to, he would choose peace over military approaches. The leading general staff was Erich von Falkenhayn, another Prussian. He used to be the Prussian Minister of War before he became the chief of the general staff. General Erich Ludendorff, who hailed from Eastern Prussia in what is now Poland, was a self-made man who rose through the ranks in the military. He viewed the world in black and white terms, in good versus bad terms, friend versus foe. You were either on his side or you were on the other side. There was no place in between. And then you have Paul von Hindenburg, who is a career military man. He is the son of a military officer, and he used education. He attended several academies, and he used the experience on the battlefield. He's a little older than Ludendorff, and he was in the Franco-Prussian War, for example, and he used that experience in the battlefield to rise to the rank of field marshal. On the Austrian side, we have a Kaiser of Austria and King of Hungary, Franz Josef. He will be in his 66th year on the throne in 1914. So people who live in Austria have only known him as the emperor. They don't know anybody else as the emperor of the nation. He's the head of that dual monarchy of Austria and Hungary. And he has really dedicated his life to maintaining peace, peace within the empire, because the empire is made up of a variety of ethnic groups, Austrians, Hungarians, Czechs, Slovaks, among others, okay? So he's trying to maintain peace within his empire. He's also very much a peace lover within the European continent. He drafted with Otto von Bismarck a dual alliance between Germany and Austria that kept peace in Central Europe for many, many years. So he's very much a pro-peace person. He hates war because war inadvertently will be bringing about change. And he's afraid that war will inspire people within his empire to rise up and bring about the end of that empire that he so carefully had crafted. And the same is true for the Prime Minister of Hungary, Count István Tisza. He very much hates war because it could potentially threaten his position within the empire. Hungary, even though it makes up a small segment within the overall population within the empire, shares equally in the monarchy. So the Kaiser, Franz Josef, will be asking Tisza to work with him, to work out problems within the empire. It's not that the Kaiser will be trumping Hungary. They both have to come to the negotiating table and work together. So Tisza as well feared war. But then you have others within the Austrian Empire, the Chief of General Staff, Franz Graf Konrad von Hötzendorf. Everybody just refers to him as Konrad. He advocates war, especially with the neighbor to the south, Serbia. He would like to incorporate Serbia into the Austro-Hungarian Empire, even though the Kaiser and the Prime Minister don't want to do that. So he is a pro-war person. And so is the foreign minister of the empire, Count Leopold Berchtold, who believes that we ought to go to war now with Serbia rather than later because Russia is out there in the background and might get involved as well. So during the July crisis that follows the assassination of Archduke Ferdinand, you have initially that funeral. It's not a celebratory funeral. It's not a funeral that a statesman would receive. So there's very little decorum. No celebrities are coming to this funeral of Franz Ferdinand, really expressing that very few people actually liked him. However, the assassination is a regicide, and the perpetrators have to be brought before court and have to be punished for what they did. And few in Europe would have objected if the Austrian-Hungarian Empire would have just walked into Belgrade, the capital of Serbia, killed a few people, deposed that government, and brought the responsible parties to justice. But the Kaiser is hesitant. He has maintained that policy of peace. Even his war minister, Alexander von Krobaten, wants to tell the Kaiser, let's go in there, let's do this real quick, let's get it over. Nobody on the European continent is going to be angry over this. But the Kaiser is hesitant. He finally gives in to these three men, but only if they can give him the assurance that Germany will back up Austria. If Germany says no, Austria will do some kind of diplomatic relationship with Serbia in order to revenge that regicide. The German emperor and the Chancellor Bethmann Hollweg indeed assured Austria that she could rely on her ally and neighbor. War Minister von Falkenhayn reported that the German military was ready for anything coming its way. To do otherwise would diminish Germany's world power status. All agreed that they should take care of the Balkan problem now rather than later. It was better to strike now because Russia was still weak after the debacle in the Russo-Japanese War. But it would return to major power status within the next 5 years. So government and military leaders in both Austria and Germany viewed war with Russia as an inevitability. But it's better to strike now while Russia is still relatively weak rather than let it become powerful and then be bogged down into a major war. These leaders in Austria and Germany also viewed war with Russia in Germanic versus Slavic terms. So they are believing that they, as superiors as Germanic people, have the right to fight a war with Slavic people, whom they consider as being more inferior. Confident German leaders took a calculated risk, believing that their military could easily defeat Russia and its ally France through a well-prepared two-front war or the Schlieffen Plan. In their minds, the war would be over by Christmas, 1914, with the Central Powers as the victors. Consequently, Germany gave Austria a blank check to proceed as it saw fit to address the regicide, and these three gentlemen are absolutely content that they can now do what they need to do. With Germany and its well-trained and equipped military on their side, Austrian officials then drew up an ultimatum for government leaders in Serbia to hand over all the people responsible for the genocide. Assassination. Little did they realize that Serbia had to refuse the ultimatum because Serbian government officials and military officials, as well as a Russian attaché, were actually part of the planning process that would result in the assassination. So in order to, you know, chop their own heads off, they couldn't say yes to the ultimatum, so they had to reject it. And they did so on July 25. Now, the Kaiser has to follow through. Since Serbia says, no, we will not do this diplomatically, he has to now declare war on Serbia on July the 28th. So it's the Habsburgers in Vienna, not the Hohenzollerns in Berlin, who decided to go to war and not use this incident of the assassination to work out problems diplomatically. Then when Russia announces it was mobilizing on July the 30th, Kaiser Wilhelm and the Chancellor decided that the threatened state of war justified their mobilization as well. And here you have the order by signed by Wilhelm and Bethmann Hollweg ordering the army and the navy to mobilize. Then Germany took another calculated risk because of that Schlieffen plan that General Schlieffen had formulated 2 years earlier. And that was a movement from northern Germany through Belgium into northern France to get to Paris. And of course, what they calculated here is that Belgium would be a nice neighbor and just let the Germans walk through unhindered so that the Germans then could be invading France. Well, Belgium said, no, you can't just walk through our country and move into France. But that now creates a problem because Belgium has a treaty with another country, Great Britain. And Great Britain now declares war on Germany on August the 4th when they cross the border from Germany into Belgium. So in essence, what we have developing here now is a two-front war for both of the countries. Germany is fighting over here in the West. But because Austria has declared war on Serbia, Russia is now also declaring war on Austria, obliging Germany then, because of the dual alliance, to declare war on Russia as well. So Germany also has an Eastern Front. Austria has an Eastern Front or a North eastern front here in Galicia with Russia, and it has a southern front with Serbia, okay? So both countries are fighting a two-front war. How is the Schlieffen Plan going in the West? Initially, it went quite well. They walked through Belgium, but Belgium is giving up more resistance than they actually expected, slowing down troop supplies. And von Moltke the Younger is making some crucial military mistakes. Fighting is breaking out here in the east, where he had expected Austria to put up most of the defensive fight, just supplied with minimal units or minimal reinforcement from the German units. But von Moltke now has to send more units over to the east, slowing down his advances even further through Belgium into northern France. He makes a few adjustments with the Schlieffen Plan, making a long story short. By September, they come to the Marne River, and that is the furthest that they will be expanding over here. So over here is the Marne River, and this is where the French and the English will be putting up a major fight before the Germans can get into Paris. They're almost literally on the outskirts of Paris itself, but with the famous taxi corps that the French put together, they're able to get enough troops out there to stop the advances by the Germans. So by December of 1914, you then have a Western Front that almost looks like an S. It goes up here from Nieburg in France, down to the Vosges Mountains in Alsace, and down here to the northern border of Switzerland. In the meanwhile, on the Eastern Front, the Royal Habsburg Army, under the leadership of General Conrad, greatly disappointed the German High Command with reckless offensives and disastrous losses along the Serbian and Russian fronts, overshadowing the great success by German generals Ludendorff and Hindenburg at the Battle of Tannenberg. A famous victory in early October of 1914, pushing the Russians who had pushed into eastern Prussia, and Ludendorff and Hindenburg had stopped them. But Conrad keeps pushing against the Russians on all kinds of individual fronts, as well as against the Serbians. They ride into Serbia, they attack, they make it actually into Belgrade, but then the Serbians get reorganized and push them right back into Austria. So in the meanwhile, Conrad is losing all kinds of men, all kinds of precious resources, and has nothing to show for it. While the Austrian and German troops fought the Russians, political squabbles now begin between the two empires about what to do about any territory that they will be gaining from the Serbians and the Russians when they win. Well, it doesn't look like they're winning at this point, does it? But they're always planning ahead, and then they get into it with each other. Chancellor Bethmann Hollweg, the German chancellor, who had drawn up the war aims for Germany in September, insisted that his country not negotiate at any cause with Russia, Britain, or France unless Germany would be accepted as the dominant power in Central Europe for what he called all imaginable time. He envisioned that little Luxembourg, right over here, would be part of Germany, and that Belgium and the Netherlands would, in essence, become vassal states to Germany. Yes, they would be autonomous, but they would be owing military and tax duties to Germany. Russia, he thought, would be retreating to approximately this line back into the old Russia under Peter the Great, and that Turkey, or the Ottoman Empire, and the Scandinavian countries would then join with this huge empire here in the middle to create an economic union. In short, Bethmann Hollweg insisted on rewards for Germany's incredible sacrifices it was encountering during this war. In December 1914, Kaiser Wilhelm II also expressed war aims, and he expressed them as, "My ideal, indeed my dream, would be to arrange an understanding with France and to capture the entire English army." Nothing like dreaming big dreams. Austrians, too, wanted spoils of war, but were less demanding. All they wanted was security in the Balkans. In other words, approximately this area back here where all the ethnic strifes were happening just on the outsides of the border of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. They also wanted peace with Italy. I don't know if you can see this on this map, but here's the Tyrol, an area that Italy would like to have. Over here is Trieste, that Italy also would like to have. So Austria would like to have all that settled once and for all as well. And of course, the Kaiser wants to maintain the dual monarchy. And others wanted parts of Poland to be annexed to the Austro-Hungarian Empire as well. Well, you would think that the Central Powers would want to set up a common command structure, that they would talk to each other, that they would develop a shared strategy in order to achieve all the goals that they have. Well, they didn't. Rather than working with one another, military leaders instead treated each other with contempt. Hindenburg and Ludendorff took pleasure in heaping verbal abuse on the so-called incompetent Austrians. Conrad, on the other hand, constantly reminded Ludendorff of one of the losses that he had experienced on the Eastern Front, the Battle of Lodz. The only thing that they could agree upon is to continue fighting instead of suing for peace, as they realized that this would not be a short war, but that this would be a protracted war. By spring 1915, Falkenhayn and the German Chancellor squabbled over new strategy on the Western Front, while Generals Ludendorff and Hindenburg increasingly influenced the Kaiser to support their attempts to stabilize the Eastern Front with Russia and address the so-called Habsburg Front. Against Falkenhayn's and Bethmann-Hollweg's objections, a combined Austrian-German assault during the summer of 1915 pushed Russian forces out of Poland back onto Russian soil. And so they're pushing up here. So they're pushing the Russians further out. But then they made a crucial mistake. They did not push Russia into negotiating a separate peace aside from the Allies, or independent from the Allies, because they feared that if you sit down and negotiate a peace rather than absolutely defeat the opponent, that would weaken the Central Powers. Therefore, Germany had to constantly send men and supplies to the Eastern Front that did not remain stable, was costly to maintain, and drew resources from the West. In the meanwhile, Austria-Hungary acquired a new enemy, because in 1915, Italy joined the Allies, and Italy immediately mobilized on the Austrian front, demanding the Tyrol and wanting the Trieste region as well. Austrian soldiers along the Isonzo River stopped any advances by the Italians, and the Isonzo River is, in essence, right here. It's a small area. It's actually a rather arid area, not much rain, but it can get extremely cold in winter, and it can change on the dime, the weather there. So it could be 50 degrees sunshine in the morning. By afternoon, you have blowing snow. So this is not the perfect place where you want to fight battles. But Austrian soldiers along the Isonzo River in the foothills of the Southern Alps confronted Italian troops on their own initially because Italy had not yet declared war on Germany. It had only declared war on Austria. So based on the politics at the time period, Germany did not initially come to the assistance of the Austrians. Italy would not declare war on Germany until 1916, and that is finally when the Germans would help. But by then, you already had repeated battles along the Isonzo River. Finally, in November 1917, at the 12th Battle of Isonzo, the Italians were defeated. This is also known as the Battle of Caporetto. And this is when the Italians are finally defeated. The Austrians only won because of the German presence fighting on their side. But little else changed along that Austrian-Italian front. You had to maintain it. You had to have troops there just in case orders would come from Italy to attack the Austrians again. So what does that do? It siphons off resources from elsewhere, right? One bright spot of good news for the Central Powers was Turkey's ability to hold off the British right here at Gallipoli. Gallipoli is a strong fortification, and the English were throwing men after men after men, and in essence trying to walk uphill. That always fails. It's never a good approach to fighting a battle, while the Turks shot down upon them from strong fortifications. Yes, the Turkish fought admirably and courageously, but they also had German advisors and they had German military hardware that they could throw at these British advances. Following this success, you then have a truly combined Central Powers attack upon Serbia. You have Austrians, Germans, Bulgarians, reinforced by Turks, attacking Serbia, and between November of 1915 and February of 1916, that leads to the ultimate defeat of Serbia. This also reopened rail traffic to Turkey, so they could be reinforced, and so the Ottoman Empire could not only set up reinforcements against Russia here in the north, the British here in the Mediterranean, but also some of the British units down here in what we today call the Middle East. But then Austria doesn't play by the rules again. The Central Powers had defeated Serbia. What do you think Austria wants to do? They want to carve it up into territory that ought to be given to the Austrian-Hungarian Empire, right? So what happens is Conrad sends units into Serbia, starts all kinds of little battles, even though Serbia has already been defeated. He even goes down into Albania and threatens to go into Greece. And the Germans are having to say, stop it, because you're drawing too many resources from elsewhere that we need to continue fighting this war. Do they constantly have to come to the rescue of Austria? Why can't they listen? Why can't they work with the German Empire? Meanwhile, on the Western Front, General Falkenhayn penned his Christmas Memorandum of 1915 that called for another attempt to break the French will to fight and thus defeat the Allies. He intended to bleed the French army white through a campaign of attrition in order to force the British to give up, or as he allegedly said, fight the British to the last Frenchman. The place of this offensive in 1916 would be Verdun, the place where the sons of Charlemagne had divided the Frankish Empire and had given birth to the future Germany. This 7 months long battle, right there, for 7 months, they threw artillery at each other, men at each other, and the line barely moved by a few kilometers. It didn't have any result whatsoever, but it introduced chlorine gas as a weapon. Not that that is a good thing. As one German general noted, this was absolute carnage. War has nothing to do with chivalry anymore. The higher civilizations rises, the more vile men become. The carnage changed little on the Western Front. The French did not give up, and neither did the British. Indeed, the British countered with their own massive offensive along the Somme River, another series of mutual mass murder. But there was one change now, because the Kaiser, Wilhelm, thought that Falkenhayn had messed up. He had used up too many resources without showing any positive gains. So what has to happen to Falkenhayn? He has to leave. And instead, what the Kaiser now does is move his two successful generals from the East Front to the Western Front. But at this moment, the Russians take advantage of this. They know how good Ludendorff and Hindenburg are as leaders of militaries. And they know how poorly successful Conrad is in shoring up the Austrian front. So the Russians take advantage of that situation and mount a massive attack upon Galicia over here, trying to push the front back to where it had been at the beginning of the war in the Carpathian Mountains. This attack resulted in almost 500,000 Austrians, Germans, and Hungarians being killed, wounded, or imprisoned. These are not men that they can really lose. General Conrad, who had a number of resources tied up on the Italian front, now had to ask Germany for help, just like a little schoolboy. Come for help. He's not worth anything within the empire anymore. Germany reluctantly transferred four divisions from the Western Front to that Eastern Front. They really could not spare these men on the Western Front. But they also forced Conrad to use units from the Italian Front, so the Italian Front even becomes a little weaker as well. This ended any independence for Conrad in Austria, was increasingly under the control of Germany. Austrians like Conrad had been overconfident in their own leadership. Generals constantly blamed lower ranking officers for failing to carry out orders and implement tactics. In reality, Conrad's leadership and his unwillingness to listen to Franz Josef, the Kaiser of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, was a major problem and eventually contributed to his dismissal in late 1916. Instead, what now happens is Kaiser Wilhelm II will be taken charge of the Eastern Front. So what has happened by late 1916, the Central Powers that used to be these four major countries are now Germany, with a Turkish and Bulgarian ally, and an Austro-Hungarian subordinate. So things have definitely changed in the power structure within the Central Powers. Austrians received additional bad news that year when their Kaiser Franz Josef died on November 21st, 1916. Austrians had only known that one leader because he had been on the throne for so long. What is that now, 68 years? People were loyal to him, not necessarily the empire, and outsiders respected his long and prosperous leadership. But by 1916, he too had become entirely disillusioned about the war. The new monarch, Karl, realized that the Austrian military had reached its limit, dismissed Conrad as the chief of the general staff, and assigned him to a minor position as a commander of forces in the Tyrol. Austria's role in the war would be limited from then on, and Emperor Karl repeatedly attempted to negotiate a separate peace with the Allies. Germany, now virtually on its own, adopted the Hindenburg program, or total war. The only way that Hindenburg and Ludendorff would understand of winning this war would be by taking all resources and spending them on investing them in that war. So the wounded, prisoners of war, women and children would now be working in the munitions production. A compulsory labor law required that every man between 17 and 60, not already in the armed forces, had to work in war-related production. To help supply minerals and metals for weapons production that were not readily available within the borders of the Central Powers, residents were asked to collect everything that they could. Donate wires, copper bells, brass ornaments, door handles, and anything else that could be melted down and turned into cannons, bullets, rifles, what have you. Factories not engaged in war production, they were shut down. Their supplies were sent elsewhere and reappropriated. The military high command, not the civilian government, was now in charge of the economy, and they set up quotas of what needed to be produced, although few factories could live up to those quotas. Concessions to higher wages and profit margins, rather than price controls, resulted in some workers and producer cooperation, but also higher costs for the government. The transportation network, however, could not keep up with the transportation needs. They could not bring enough raw material to the factories, and then they could not send enough produced products back to the front. Indeed, during the winter of 1917 and 1918, all kinds of new artillery, mortars, hand grenades, and other weaponry rusted in harbors, because they could not be transported. The trains were not there to transport them to the fronts. The public that had enthusiastically supported the war in 1914 and 1915 began to protest in 1916. Why? Because they had to live with rations. Their daily intake of food was drastically reduced. Bread you could no longer just make out of wheat or out of oats. It becomes increasingly darker as you had to use the darker grains for that, if not mix it with other substitutes. Increasingly, the potatoes were sent to the soldiers on the front, and you at home ate turnips instead. Okay, such as the famous or infamous turnip winter during 1916 through 1917. In essence, what you have is the establishment of what they called the ersatz economy or the substitute economy, and there's all kinds of different patents for new foods. For example, there are 837 patents for new sausages that are increasingly not made out of meat, but other things. Okay? And then you have 511 patent applications for coffee that does not contain a single coffee bean in there, okay? So they're coming up with all kinds of new foods in order for people to survive. So why did the high command, which in essence consisted of these two men, Ludendorff and Hindenburg, why did they believe that they had to go and transition to this total war approach? They were convinced that for the only way for the empire to survive was to win this war. If they had to sit down and negotiate, the empire would be falling apart. Therefore, you have to have a peace with territory. You have to be defined as the winner, and you have to have spoils of war. Otherwise, your empire is going to fall apart. Your people will be rising up. They will be conducting a revolution. And there were movements underfoot within the empire that indicated that the people were indeed sick and tired. But these two men totally ignored these movements within. Instead, they pushed. They wanted more territory. And they were willing to give up Austria in return. Wilhelm II would have preferred to end the alliance with Austria overall, rather than give up any potential territory that he could gain from France or Belgium or Luxembourg. Scandals over Emperor Karl's alleged concessions to France that it had indeed the right to Alsace-Lorraine, which Germany had taken from them in the 1870-71 war, only further weakened Austria's stature in the alliance. Indeed, Hindenburg now becomes so audacious that he tells Emperor Karl of Austria that gaining Bohemia, which is a part of Western Austria, for Germany would be the icing on his retirement. So these two countries definitely no longer get along with each other. But this also shows how confident these men were that Germany would still win. Their ideals were totally disconnected from the realities of the home front. They had no idea or interest in knowing just how hungry or tired the German people, the German workers, and the German soldiers were off war. In order to achieve their objective, in addition to the Hindenburg program, the High Command now formulated two new strategies. The first strategy was the resumption of unlimited warfare, submarine warfare. They had initially conducted in 1914 and early 1915 submarine warfare around the British Isles and Ireland in order to take resources away from Great Britain. But they had to reduce their attack when they sunk the Lusitania, because President Woodrow Wilson had threatened in 1915, if you don't stop this unlimited submarine warfare, we will be joining this war. and the Kaiser and his diplomats had negotiated with the United States. We will not sink ships that are flying under a neutral flag. We will instead come up out of the water, threaten to sink a ship, ask them to show what they have on board. If it's contraband, the German submariners will be confiscating it, will be allowing the sailors to come off the ships and then sink the ship. Well, that's really hurting a lot of people. That's not bringing the British to their knees. That is not taking a lot of contraband from Great Britain. So they're now resuming this unlimited warfare, and they know that there's a risk attached to this, because if they're resuming unlimited submarine warfare in early 1917, guess who's going to join in this war? The United States, right? But now you have these very confident military leaders expressing their thoughts about the United States. Ludendorff, for example, says, "I don't give a damn about America." Hindenburg considers the potential impact of the United States as minimal, in any case, not decisive. And the Kaiser, he thinks America is totally irrelevant. That gives you a little insight into how these men were thinking. These guys who are running this, not only the country, but in essence the military and this total war. The strategy of unlimited submarine warfare failed. These leaders had faulty statistics. They just had no idea just how much material was coming to Great Britain and how many resources they had, not just coming from the United States, but you know, the British Empire is huge, right? They have resources coming in from Canada, resources coming up from Australia and New Zealand. So the Germans had totally miscalculated just how many resources the British Empire could be tapping into. They also ignored how extensive the trade between the United States and Great Britain was, and for how long it had already existed, and how much money the United States had already poured into Great Britain. They also ignored the use of what the British instigated here, and that is the use of convoys. Convoys are, it's not just one ship crossing the Atlantic, but you have protective ships coming with them. So you as a submariner, as the captain of a U-boat, you have to choose which one of those 12 ships are you going to sink. And if you sink one, guess what? At least two other ships are going to come after you with depth charges, right? So it's risky to attack a convoy. And then, of course, in the end, they didn't have enough submarines to really make that much of a difference. But it brought in the United States into the war. Chancellor Bethmann Hollweg was totally opposed to the approach that these three men were taking. But as tradition shows, if you don't go along with the Kaiser and the men that the Kaiser supports, what happens to you? Well, they encourage you to resign. Absolutely, right? And the Chancellor resigns July 13, 1917. Very few people mourned his leaving. They thought he was weak, that he should have stood up stronger to the Kaiser. He was far too often willing to negotiate, but so he has to leave. William II then appoints Georg Michaelis as the next chancellor. He is very much a supporter of Ludendorff and Hindenburg, so the war continues. The second strategy that the high command focused on was to finally end fighting in the east. Things have been stabilizing. The front in the east is actually being pushed a little further towards Russia itself. And they know the German leaders actually do have good information about the east, what's happening in Russia. There's lots of unrest, and you have a revolution happening in March of 1917, when the government of Tsar Nicholas II is overthrown and a new government under Kerensky is being established. What the High Command now does is set aside a special train for one individual person, and that is Vladimir Lenin, who is living in exile in Switzerland. They will be using this train to get him to Petrograd, indeed stopping munitions transportations and troop transportations to give this train priority on tracks to get him to Petrograd, because they know he wants to reform Russia, he wants to end a war that does not seem to pay off for Russia itself. So they're letting him through, he gets to Petrograd, he tries to work with Kerensky, but Kerensky refuses to sue for peace. He keeps throwing Russian men at the German forces. The German forces keep pushing ever harder against Russian troops that are sick and tired of fighting a war that does not seem to get them anything either. And making a long story short, what does Lenin do by October of 1917? He conducts a second revolution and lets Germany know we're ready to sue for peace. So what you have coming out of this then is a treaty, an independent treaty signed between Russia and Germany that establishes this as the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk line. So the Russians have drastically withdrawn from the European continent. All this entire area now becomes unofficial, or because of that treaty, part of the German Empire. And what do you have here? You have the Ukraine here. The Ukraine is known as a breadbasket. Lots of grains that can be harvested, they have to be planted first, but can be harvested by fall of 1918 to feed the German people, to feed the German soldiers. You also have other things here. You have oil, you have copper, you have iron deposits that can now be extracted and can be sent to the munitions factories in Germany. So this is a major improvement for Germany, this treaty. And this now encourages the high command of Hindenburg, of Ludendorff, and the Kaiser to formulate the next final approach to bringing about a short victory. And that would be pulling everything that you have from over here, because you've made peace. There's no more need for troops over here, right? Put them on the trains, send them over here, and conduct one final go for all, win or lose, attack. Break the French lines, break the British lines before who arrives? The Americans, right? The Germans had absolutely correctly calculated that that the United States, even though it declared war upon Germany in April of 1917, would not arrive until 1918. Because we only had a military of about 200,000 men. Half of that was actually National Guard, which were, for the very first time was nationalized in a foreign conflict. But those 200,000 men would make absolutely no difference in a war that has already cost millions in lives, right? So it would take the United States almost 10 months to raise men through the Selective Service Act, through the draft, get them trained, and then when they were sent over to France, our General Pershing insisted that they would be trained in the backcountry of France before they would be sent into the trenches. So when the Germans begin their Operation Michael on the Western Front in March 20, 1918, that is exactly the same point at which the Americans slowly but surely begin to arrive. If they can just break through that line within 10 days, they will have won the war. They will have brought the French to their knees and will have brought the British to their knees before the Americans would be there in full force. At least that's the gamble that they're taking. And of course, the collateral in this gamble is going to be the nation or the empire of Germany, the remainder of the Central Powers. Operation Michael began on the morning of March 21, 1918. With what one historian called a hurricane of fire and thunder. The front moved westward by up to 90 miles in some places, but the German forces were not able to break through the British or French lines. Any holes that appeared in the French or British lines were now filled with American troops. Operation Michael had not driven the British into the sea, and the French had not collapsed. Ludendorff and Hindenburg, as well as the Kaiser, instead celebrated and deceived themselves into believing that they had received and achieved a victory, and that morale was extremely high in the military. Colonels, captains, sergeants, and corporals, however, knew that the situation on the front was entirely different. Soldiers were exhausted, hungry, and tired of what they viewed a suicide mission that resulted in high casualty rates in the name of getting some territory. They were ready to go home, while the general staff and high command celebrated. Excuse me. The ordinary soldier knew that the enemy lines had held and that they were receiving reinforcements from America. By July, the end of the offensive, 250,000 Americans were arriving in France every month. In contrast, the offensive had cost the German military 1 million men. And tens of thousands of German soldiers were deserting as the Allies advanced. Yet Ludendorff and Hindenburg still could not bring themselves to accept that they had lost. As American forces were turning the tide on the battlefield, in late summer 1918, developments on the home front forever changed Germany. Military reports sent on October 3, 1918, to a new chancellor. He was the third chancellor after Bethmann Hollweg was let go, and who was a proponent of peace, indicated that the war had been lost on the Western Front. This inspired the chancellor to contact Woodrow Wilson regarding an immediate armistice and a peace based on Wilson's 14 points. Wilson's insistence to speak with only the elected representatives of the German people, that is the Reichstag, then inspired the members of the Reichstag to act on their own behalf and conduct their own revolution. They passed legislation that placed them in charge of the military rather than the three men. And they established a republic without a monarch, and they negotiated an armistice. On October 26, Ludendorff, giving up, resigned from the military, predicting that the empire would come to an end within no time at all. Austria and Turkey now sued for an independent peace with the Allies, and an armistice in the Balkans went into effect on November 3. After much debate with the Chancellor, the Kaiser abdicated on November 9, and he left for exile in the Netherlands the following day. Finally, on the 11th hour of the 11th month, the Western Front fell silent. The Treaty of Versailles, signed in June 1919, decimated the old German and Austro-Hungarian empires physically and financially. Monarchists like Ludendorff and Hindenburg, however, began a myth that they perpetuated into the 1930s, that Germany could have won the war on its own terms had it not been stabbed in the back by its own people, especially members of the Reichstag, including socialists and communists. So I hope what I have demonstrated here today is that the ideologists held by the individuals in power influenced many of the political and military decisions in both the German and Austro-Hungarian empires. The clash of competing interests between the two empires placed Austria into a subordinate position to Germany, especially after Emperor Franz Joseph died. Conflicting interests within the German Empire subordinated the Chancellor and even the Kaiser to the military high command that in essence consisted of two men, General Ludendorff and Field Marshal Hindenburg. Their interests or insistence on demanding peace with territory and inability or unwillingness to face the realities on both the military and home front contributed to the defeat of Germany and its humiliation through the Treaty of Versailles. Any questions? Oops. There's supposed to be a slide that says, any questions? That went away. Well, it doesn't show up. Oh, well. Okay, do we have any questions?
Happy to come to you if you don't want to get up.
Yeah.
And I was late, so if you said this early on, I apologize. But I was wondering, with World War I followed so closely by World War II, mm-hmm. and like the German people, you said, were supportive of this, of World War I.
Initially, yeah.
Initially, but then by the end, they realized, you know, what war is like, et cetera, et cetera. How did they get on board so quickly for the next war?
For one reason, because the myth was perpetuated that Ludendorff and Hindenburg had begun about the being stabbed in the back by the socialists and the communists. One of the things that Hitler did in the 1930s, as soon as he came legally to power as the chancellor, was to point the finger. Here are the people who were responsible for our misery in the 1920s as a result of the Treaty of Versailles. They need to be kicked out. They need to be sent into the labor camps that eventually would becoming the concentration camps. He pointed the finger at them because he, after all, was a soldier in World War I and had fought under, you know, his famous generals. Indeed, he kept on Hindenburg as the president of Germany while he was chancellor. And a lot of people fell for that myth, because the 1920s had been so problematic. The 1920s began with this hyperinflation as a result of the reparation payments that the Treaty of Versailles placed upon the Germans, right? So lots of people lost jobs, lost anything and everything that they had ever owned, because money was worthless. You had to literally take a wheelbarrow to the grocery store to get just a sack of groceries, right? So people were very quickly convinced, based on that myth, that their leader is looking out for them, and therefore all the other countries in the world. France was responsible for the Treaty of Versailles. Great Britain was responsible for the Treaty of Versailles. So there needed to be that revenge. Does that help you understand a little bit? Okay.
When you were referring to how the economy and the food supply and mm-hmm. everything was just driven, I'm wondering how some of the neutral countries, in particular maybe Scandinavia, even if they were neutral, how was their economy still affected, or possibly their food supply? You know, we live in a different era now with everything
sure.
being so global, but, you know, they probably had their own resources. But can you talk a little bit about what living was like in Scandinavia during World War I?
Living in Scandinavia was fairly decent. You were not really that strongly affected by that, especially since the United States remained neutral for so long. So they had initially that trading partner, right? So the United States was neutral, Scandinavia was neutral, so they maintained any and all trading practices, and they would do so even after the United States entered the war on the continent, okay? You do have sympathizers for either side within Scandinavia, but the country, all the countries, Norway, Sweden, Denmark, are remaining neutral. So having these leaning ideologies, as long as you don't blurt them out in the open, doesn't really harm you that much, okay? They're not really drastically, negatively impacted by this war. Indeed, they're crafting stronger ties with the United States, with each other, or other overseas powers. Does that help? Okay.
Hi there. Do you have a slide that shows how everything was divided up at the end of World War I?
Not here. Not with me. Yeah. But I can point. I can try and give you an idea. If we look at this map, of course, Alsace-Lorraine goes back to France. Sizable chunk of Eastern Prussia actually goes into a new country that's called Poland. Out of Austria-Hungary, you have a small Austria down here. You have an independent Hungary. you have several countries here coming together, beginning to create what's called Yugoslavia. And then you have, of course, Romania getting new borders, Bulgaria getting new borders. You have Czechoslovakia here in the middle carved out. So that's in essence how they are carved up. And then the Italian border is also adjusted with the Tyrol going to Italy.
Okay, thank you. And then my other question was, and I think I missed this bit, but when the old emperor of Austria, mm-hmm. Hungary, died, mm-hmm. he'd been the one that had been in power for 66 years or something?
68 years by the time he died, yeah.
So who inherited that?
Karl. It's a grandnephew of his.
And what happened to him? Because he's just sort of not mentioned.
Yeah, he's emperor for about 2 years. And once the Austrian-Hungarian Empire is being carved up, he has to abdicate because they too will become a republic. Austria itself will become a republic. Hungary will become its own country. They already have a parliament with a prime minister in it, but they had shared power within the Austro-Hungarian Empire. So they're becoming their own now. Very much a nationalistic movement that you will actually have happening there in Hungary. They're proud to be finally on their own and to make decisions for themselves instead of always having to share power with the Austrians, right? But Austria really becomes a very small country, mm-hmm. And now with a parliament and a prime minister. So a major change in that country undergoing as well.
And then through World War I and World War II, how does Switzerland manage to stay neutral? Is it because of the topography?
Not necessarily. It's also the hub of money, finances in Europe. Do you want to keep your money in our banks, accept our neutrality? Otherwise, we're going to put sanctions on the money that you have in our banks, and a lot of foreign countries, foreign business owners have money in Swiss banks. So them holding that money as not collateral, blackmail, mm-hmm. In essence, will keep them as a neutral country.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Sure.
So what happens to the countries just south of Russia and north of Romania, or that land? What does that all become?
Ukraine.
Oh, right.
Okay. Yeah, that's Ukraine. There's the peninsula that no longer is part of it. It's eventually that Russia, when it becomes the Soviet Union, will eventually incorporate Ukraine, because the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk will go away with the Versailles Treaty. Okay, so the Ukraine will actually, and then up here you have actually Belarus, and then up here you have the Baltic provinces, Lithuania, Latvia, and Lithuania, which eventually will also be taken in by the Soviet Union. Okay, but that actually happens more after World War II. It's that limbo that they're in during that 20-year time period between the two wars. So they actually experience some independence, which then will make Soviet occupation worse after World War II, because they had that minimal taste of autonomy, independence during those 20 years.
Hi, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about the monarchies that were removed. I know you talked about the German and the Austrian, but uh-huh. certainly there were others. I'm just curious.
Of course, the British monarchy does not get removed, that they survive, right? Greece, you actually have a revolution happening down here. The Ottomans totally fall apart, because the Ottoman Empire is totally being carved up with the Treaty of Versailles into Turkey itself, and then all these other countries like Lebanon and so on being created through independence movements, having their own forms of government set up. Iraq is being created, for example, with its own separate independent government. Let's see, are there any other... There we go. Spain is surviving because it was a neutral country, but very quickly, with the fascist movement that develops during the 1920s, we'll see an end coming to its monarchy, or briefly coming to an end. They still have a monarch today. But it's a constitutional monarchy. So the most dramatic impact is that there is no more Kaiser here, that there is no more Kaiser here, that it's actually divided into two countries. The King of Belgium is still there today, and so is the Queen of the Netherlands. So in between, you also have a king. Sweden is still a constitutional monarchy. Okay, so Norway is as well. So for some remaining neutral, assisted in maintaining their monarchies, whereas the Germans and the Austrians that threw everything into the empire, as well as Turkey, suffered the most and lost their monarchies. Does that help? Okay.
First of all, thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
I know very generally about World War I, mm-hmm. so I really appreciate this explanation. A lot of moving parts.
Yes.
And I was just thinking, as you were talking, it's like, it's like just the arrogance and the egos. It's kind
absolutely.
Of like, you know, same, different day today. Mm-hmm. And then last question is Montenegro.
Mm-hmm.
Could you talk about that? I mean, I've heard the name, but I don't know, is it a monarchy? What was its role during World War I? And I believe it still exists today.
It still is, they're still trying to get true independence nowadays. Montenegro was a province within the Austro-Hungarian Empire. It had been conquered by the Austrian several years earlier. And it's one of those many ethnic groups, because the Montenegrins think of themselves as different from the Serbians, as different from the Bosnians, as different from the Croats. And if you really look at the map of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, you have the Slovenians, you have the Croats, you have the Bosnians, you have the Serbians, the Montenegrins. They will, because when they're getting Serbia, they will be getting the Kosovars and the Albanians in there as well, briefly. But it's part of this hodgepodge of ethnic identities within the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And it really, they then become incorporated in this new country that they call Yugoslavia. And Yugoslavia is not going to become a monarchy. It's going to become a dictatorship eventually, subsequently under Tito. So you don't have, they're trying to establish representative forms of government because they believe in the 14 points that Wilson is talking about, this idea of self-determination, that a people who are of a common ethnic linguistic background have the right to create their own borders. But they're not successful at the end of World War I because they're being incorporated into this new Yugoslavia that is being created. But it's this desire to be independent that still is present today. Slovenes, Croats, and Bosnia-Herzegovina exist as independent countries today, right? And Montenegro is still trying to get its own today. Okay. Any other question?
This will be our last question.
Oh.
My ancestors, my grandfather came from that area, and he was from the Austro-Hungarian Empire, my grandmother and my grandfather. And he had a picture of him in the Prussian army mm-hmm. uniform, as well as his brother. Can you explain what role did the Prussian army have in this World War, or did they?
It is the army, because after all, it was Prussia that had created the German Empire in 1871, right? It's that Prussian drive. That's why Ludendorff is from Prussia, Hindenburg is from Prussia, Falkenhayn is from Prussia, the Kaiser is from Prussia. So the entire leadership is from Prussia, and the German military, in essence, is the Prussian military. You have the discipline of the Prussian military, the uniform of the Prussian military, including that famous helmet, right? That spiked helmet. Yeah. So the Prussian military is the guiding force here in that war. The Austro-Hungarians have their own uniforms, but once they're subordinated to the German military, then they will actually be changing uniforms and will be embracing, not embracing, it will be placed upon them, the discipline of the Prussian military. They're not voluntarily embracing that, okay, because it's one of the toughest militaries that you could ever be fighting in. The discipline is just unheard of at the time period. Well, does that help?
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Dewitt.
You're welcome.
Another round of applause. And thank you from the National World War I Museum Memorial.
Okay, thank you.